to thank you for coming out tonight. Today we're going to have a debate regarding the proposition written behind me on the blackboard. And it reads, this House believes that direct action is a preferred and more effective means to create desired change than through legislative reform regarding the environment. Today on the affirmative side, I have one of my partners, Zainab. She's a classmate of mine. And I also have Mr. Leslie James Pickering, a former spokesperson for the Earth Liberation Front. They will be arguing on the affirmative side regarding direct action as opposed to legislative reform. And on the negative side, I have my professor, Professor Joe Leeson-Schatz, and his teammate is TJ. He's on the debate team here at Binghamton University. And hope you guys enjoy and get something great out of today. So,
Dana? So I'm going to begin by with my opening argument. So, first of all, I would like to thank all of you for attending this debate. The fact that you are all here shows the importance of this cause and the resolution we are debating. So, to be stated, we will be discussing how direct action is a preferred and more effective way to produce desired change than through legislative reform, especially when it comes to the environment. Let me first begin to defend this argument by describing the numerous complexities associated with legislative reform that hinder the process and prove it to be ineffective. Disruptive factors include political incentives, career goals of regulators, and the lengthy process of enforcing regulation. Also, the sheer inefficiency of the whole system as a whole. For example, an in-depth look at the bureaucracy of the Environmental Protection Agency highlights these main points. A retired EPA regulator of 30 years, William Sandor, describes his points in his article, Designed to Fail, Why Regulatory Agencies Don't Work. In this article, it is discussed how specifically EPA regulators are prevented against creating legislation that directly regulates corporations. Because the corporations can be very powerful, they have influence over the agencies and the policies created as well. For example, Sandor states how he was told to put a loophole in creating legislation difficult enough not to be obvious, but there so that when corporations needed to, they could still possibly work their way around it. This just goes to show how hollow and superficial these regulatory laws can be. Similarly, because the power of a large business and special interests can have, oftentimes regulators were the objects of courtships. As Sandra quotes, when I was in the charge of writing regulations, I too was the object of this, showered with flattery, meals, trips, and hints of future employment. Those who don't cooperate with these lobbyists end up having these people lobbying for their heads. So how can the regulators be expected to create effective measures to protect environments if there are agencies providing incentives to do otherwise? Especially if someone's job is on the line, how could one's first priority then be making legislation that could potentially incite the wrath of some powerful figures in business and politics? Also, there is a factor of the revolving door, where individuals within the EPA often found jobs outside the agency working for the groups that benefited from these ineffective laws being passed. So therefore, if there's a promise of a high-paying job after working as an incompetent regulator, how many people would pass that up? Also, even if these regulators who aren't tempted by these offers are not fazed by the prospect of making enemies of influential people, these brave individuals did not last long in the agency. As Sandra states, people like me, people who like to get things done, who need to see concrete results for their efforts, don't last long. The people who get ahead are those clever ones with the talent for procrastination, obfuscation, and coming up with superficially plausible reasons for accomplishing nothing. If an environmental agency is filled with these kind of career-oriented people who do not care for the well-being of the environment, how is the agency expected to accomplish any real meaningful legislation that protects the environment like the name suggests and prevents companies from exploiting it? If the agency repeatedly rewards those who do nothing and reprimands those who do wish to protect the environment, how will the ecosystems in desperate need of preservation and the endangered species be expected to survive with such corrupt institutions in place? If the very agency named to protect the environment is actually working against this goal, isn't it justified that more directions be taken? So direct actions are described to be actions that go outside the law in order to induce change. Examples include sabotage, civil disobedience, and the destruction of property, all with the goal of changing society. So one example is the cattle horse slaughterhouse in Oregon. The Earth Liberation Front was accredited with burning down the slaughterhouse that was killing horses. These horses were wild horses that were taken and adopted by the government under the guise of for governmental activities. What was actually happening though is that these wild horses were killed and that their blood was polluting the sewer system. So the Environmental Liberation Front burned down the slaughterhouse that was causing so much destruction. This is an example of a direct action taken against a measure by the law in order to produce a desired change in society. So even the laws that are in place in government aren't effective at all, to some extent the impact of these measures aren't effective because they take so long to produce. Even if an inspector finds a violation, this only triggers a lengthy, complex process with many levels of warning, review, appeal, negotiation, and agitation before any actions taken, or more often voided. So therefore, even if a protective measure has been put in place, in most situations it is a long, time-consuming process that produces little effect. Also, there is a breadth of work that must be done to produce a desired environmental change in society. Things like overpopulation, deforestation, and the exploitation of resources are all major problems that require a breadth of goals and issues to be tackled. If a movement is created, like direct action would produce, it would be better and more effective as opposed to legislation and specific policies addressing each individual factor. Right now, we are currently experiencing the worst fate of species die-offs since the dinosaurs 65 million years ago. Although extinction is a natural phenomenon, it occurs at a natural background rate of about 1 to 5 species per year. People estimate that we're now losing a species at 1,000 to 10,000 times the background rate, but literally dozens going extinct every day. Also, there's a major issue of deforestation. 16 million square kilometers of tropical rainforest that originally existed worldwide have been decimated so that only 9 million square kilometers remain today. The current rate of deforestation is 160,000 square kilometers per year, which equates to almost a loss of approximately 1% of the original forest habitat. This is an issue because our legislation does not tackle these problems directly. Our legislation is very, very entwined with capitalism. Because capitalism prioritizes the needs of private interests over the needs of the environment and marginalized people, legislation is not effective in prioritizing these people's goals. The earth and second-class citizens in third world countries are seen as commodities by capitalism and are exploited to create more profit. At best, legislation that would work to moderate the pace and in destruction caused by capitalism, but ultimately capitalism could never legislate its way out of existence. Oftentimes also direct action can be seen as messy or destructive, but there's no other path that addresses the same issue. So finally, because capitalism is a violent attack against the environment and marginalizes people, direct action is essentially a method of self-defense against this. Thank you.
Thank you. We agree with a lot of what the proposition started with saying. We think that the rate of species extinction, the rate of deforestation, all of these things are incredibly alarming. And we need to be able to find ways to take action in order to be able to solve these horrific events and these in order to be able to live tomorrow. However, we do not think that direct action is the best way to go about promoting environmental conservation or helping other animals. This is true for a couple of reasons. First, as a presupposition, people are not that great. Generally, people are relatively self-interested. This is why we have deforestation and why capitalism allows people to be able to wreak havoc on the environment for personal gains. However, this means that we need to work with the people as they exist in order to show them that it's in their best interest to not be destroying the environment. When you go out there to spike trees or hold up signs and take protests, that doesn't help win over people in the middle. It pushes them further away. When you take away people's livelihoods because they can't do logging, it's not going to get them to stop logging. It's just going to get them to become increasingly agitated and have even more restrictive laws be put in place. Legislation and reform ultimately are strategies that can work. The proposition says that it might be slow and it might be tedious. And this might be true. Bureaucracy is not the best invention that humans have ever created, nor are the regulatory agencies that are set to actually be out there protecting them. But it's a lot better than allowing for individuals who think that they know the answer to go out there and potentially harm other individuals or take to the streets or burn down personal property or essentially allow for a mob mentality to be able to decide what what justice is and how our environment should be moving. Democracy is a slow-moving process, but that process is one that has been able to make gains. We've seen SeaWorld take a stance in order to be able to eliminate orcas. We've seen Barnum & Bailey Circus willing to eliminate elephants from their acts. These are examples that have been taking years and years of pressure from various different groups and individuals to try and convince them to make those changes, and they eventually did. When we try and do something more radical, it pushes people away and prevents those changes from taking place. Direct action and protest almost always inevitably creates backlash. As someone who has recently gone out to protest circuses in Binghamton, I know that it's not always the best way to reach people, because people will say, well, what about the performers? What about the children? Aren't there more important things to worry about? And it ends up creating increased resentment it pushes people further away from reaching that middle ground territory. But when you engage in people not on the streets, but you do it within academic formats, through legislative practices or through town hall meetings, these are ways where you can begin to chip away and erode people's fast-held beliefs and begin to pull them over into your territory. Also, when you engage in some of the direct actions that the proposition mentioned, such as burning down personal property or sabotaging, these things, if you get caught, can land you in jail. And I promise you that even if it might be slow going to promote change, all the best activists and people who care about the environment end up in jail, that's going to make change come to a screeching halt. In order for change to be realizable, we need the people who are pushing for the change to stay out of jail in order to be able to continuously move forward. Also, direct action is not a strategy that is necessarily available to everyone. Some people are more able to take on direct action. With my socioeconomic position as a white middle-class male, it's very easy for me to go out in the streets and protest. It's very easy for me to utilize legal systems in a way that benefit me to keep me out of jail if I engage in certain actions. But not everyone has those same privileges. People with different skin colors, cultures, races, or economic standing don't have access to the same privileges to keep them out of jail, which means that it is better for us to find a strategy that is more accessible for everybody to be able to gain access to, so that way we can have a coalition of efforts in order to promote change, opposed to just assuming that it's a couple of white males at the forefront being able to take this action. The book Monkey Wrenching was predominantly focused on white men taking action to monkey wrench corporations. And while they were able to promote some sort of limited change, it did not end the logging industry. It did not end any of these things. The Sea Shepherd Conservation Society, for all the work that they're doing trying to take on Japanese whaling, it has not stopped Japanese whaling. Direct action is a failing strategy. It has not produced lasting change, because the only lasting change that can take place is when governments are willing to get behind it, which is ultimately one of the fundamental arguments that we'll be advancing, is that even in the world where direct action might be desirable because we have to do something now in order to protect the environment, it is only successful if that direct action ends in legislative initiatives and actual policy changes, which means that even in the world where we think regulatory agencies are bad, their endpoint of solving requires us to utilize regulatory agencies to get there. In addition, there is always a risk that monkey wrenching or burning down personal property or any of those things might end up hurting people. They will be right that the Earth Liberation Front has not killed any human in their actions so far today. They will be right that a lot of the monkey wrenching takes place does not end up injuring people. But there's always that inevitable risk, and it's never worth trading off somebody's life to push forth your own form of agenda. Further, when you hurt people's livelihoods and they suddenly lose their logging business or lose the way that they're able to get funds to feed their family because they're no longer able to work in factory farms, these things are not going to help you win allies. Rather, we need to take legislative initiatives to help create other positive outlets for people to be able to find jobs and for people to have other ways to be able to get money. To just say, we shouldn't hurt the environment, we shouldn't deforest, doesn't come up with viable alternatives that legislatively could be created that could pull people away from destroying the environment to more renewable technologies and things like that. Engaging people in a way that teaches them how that they can personally benefit from pro-environmental policies is going to be better at convincing people to make those changes than simply saying we should burn it down. Thank you.
I'm Olivia. I'm another one of Joe's students, and I also helped attend the debate. Right now, our debaters are preparing for the cross-examination, which is just a two-minute period where they can ask each other questions and be able to form their arguments for the next round of speeches. If you have any questions for the debaters, Andy has different little cards and he has pens that he can pass out to you. If you just raise your hand and like one, and you know, you can hand it back to him. And you can ask these at any time during the cross period, but we'll ask them to the debaters afterwards during filter Q&A. So, are you ready to start the cross examination? I'll look at the question.
Is it just both sides asked?
Yep. I'll hold up time cards for 1 and 32.
I have a question for you all. I'm curious about, in your first speech, you talked about a lot of like direct action and things like getting rid of like, slaughterhouses with horses. But how for like an issue like, say, like black rhinos in Africa, how does like direct action, like, how can that be applied to like a situation like that, that is a less like organized and like there's one thing that you can attack, or specifically like one business to attack? So like, how could direct action solve for that kind of issue?
Direct action has been used by many movements in many different places around the world. And a situation like rhinos being poached in Africa, is that what you're saying? I mean, you know, you'd have to look at the specific situation. The whole concept behind direct action is that it's direct rather than indirect.
Okay.
And don't go after something, a third party, to try to affect something happening, but you go against the direct.
But there are human beings shooting rhinos. You know, guns are pretty easily to get available. It's difficult to not have access to that. So, like, my question is, without hurting human beings, how do you stop rhinos from being hunted?
You can destroy their property, destroy their guns, destroy the methods they use, the cars they use to affect those rhinos. The tools they use to try and find those rhinos and the tools they use that they try to kill those rhinos, but can destroy that.
Any questions?
You mentioned the example of the whaling from the Japanese that the Sea Shepherd seeks to prevent. But isn't that whaling a result of a policy where the Sea Shepherd that the Japanese use to conduct whaling under the guise of scientific research? Because I think there's an international law that says...
Yeah. No, the International Whaling Commission definitely created laws that allow for a certain degree of whaling to be able to take place. Prior to those laws creation, Japan was whaling even more. And so the end point of what Sea Shepherd needs to realize is that the International Whaling Commission is going to have to be able to have a total ban and pose the line for exceptions. And so this was one legislative initiative that could then have future legislative attempts that could then better be able to address whaling in its entirety.
Okay, so you're saying that in the end, that the legislation measure at the end is what determines the effectiveness of the...
It's always a step-by-step process, and
okay.
So no single policy will solve all of the harms, but each one is going to move us in a trajectory to create a better world.
So what happens if a direct action ends with legislation? Would that direct action be more effective than the legislation?
No, because you need the legislation at the end for its effectivity.
The point is there's no long-term change unless that legislation happens, and our point is that direct action is less likely to lead to legislation than academic discussion and argumentation.
So like, what if you take for the...
We need to actually a couple lectures. Now, if you guys would like to take a minute or two to extract your arguments for your rebuttal, you'll have 5 minutes to take your speech.
There's another 2 minutes.
How much time is
this? You have 5 minutes. Whatever you'd like to say.
Okay. So, It was quoted that the only lasting change is when governments get behind it, and that's the sort of notion that we're hearing here, that the only way to create lasting change is when legislation is passed and governments are backing the lasting change. But realistically, and if you look at it historically, you can see clearly that the only lasting change has happened throughout history has happened because people have forced it to happen. You know, slavery wasn't abolished because the government up and decided it was a good idea and legislators decided that, you know, we're going to do this for the egalitarian purposes. You know, same thing with indigenous people in this country and women's rights. Every single movement has had elements of people who force change to happen because it's not happening through legislation. It's not happening on its own. Legislation happens in reaction to people's movements who push very hard. You know, and those people come from all walks of life, not just white males who are middle class. You know, in fact, the majority of direct action happens by people who are marginalized, like Rosa Parks. indigenous people who live in this country. Now we're looking at things across the world, third world countries, people fighting by any means necessary to bring about change. And, you know, and every time that significant laws have been passed, it's because people's movements have pushed them forward. And I would argue that, you know, the only lasting change is not when governments get behind it, but when people fight for it. We force the government even the whole concept of the government in this country is supposed to be that it's representing the best interests of the people. The people have to express their best interests. And when the government isn't listening, you have to force them to listen. You know, it's not up to us how hard we fight. If we could, you know, just pass bills left and right or sign petitions to solve these major global problems, we'd be doing it. You know, people who are so known globally for their radicalism, like, say, Malcolm X, if he could have sat down and just signed petitions all day, I promise you, that's exactly what he would have done. You don't have that choice. You don't have that privilege. You know, that's not an option when it comes to the environment. If we just sit around and wait for these corporations to pass really protective laws, well, I'm sorry, those people, in June, they're working for the EPA, and in December, they're on the board of Monsanto, and then they go back again the next January and work for the EPA. That's the way it works. It's not really, nobody is in the government to represent the environment. The environment isn't represented, it's not a person. But corporations are considered people, and they are representing the government. So you have a situation that's totally unbalanced. If they don't create legislation meant to defend the animals or marginalized people or the environment, then we have to show them that that's what's that that's what is important to us, that that is what the people's interests are. And we do that by speaking up, by acting out. And if the more direct our actions are, the better. Because then they know that we really care. If they think that we're only interested to the point where we're going to sign petitions and maybe hold a sign, then that's how important it is to us. But if they understand that we're going to do it by organizing the Montgomery bus boycott, that Martin Luther King is going to be going to jail over and over again, and that it's going to be on the front page of the news over and over again, well, then it becomes more important. You know, and if it's expressed to the point where, you know, the Black Panther Party is fighting in the streets with the police over and over again and making the news and their people are dying, well, then that's even more important. If we tell the system, this government, that the environment is only as important as signing a petition, then they're going to think that that's the level of response that's adequate on the legislative level. It's inadequate. It's not acceptable. The species rate is out of control. Of extinction is out of control. The degradation of the environment is beyond fixing at this point. We need to save what's left. There's only 2% left of old-growth forests in North America, and that needs to be saved. And capitalism, as we mentioned, exists and runs. It's like exploitation of the environment and people is the fuel in which capitalism runs. And this is a capitalist society. So if you don't address that by thinking that everything can be fixed through reforms, legislative reforms, well, then you're missing the whole point. All we're going to get is crumbs. We're going to get one species put on the endangered species list. We're going to get another ineffective piece of legislation passed, like the Clean Air or the Clean Water Act, and we're just going to keep on plowing forward towards global ecological annihilation. We cannot allow that to happen. It's our responsibility to save this planet for our children and our children's children, whether or not it's comfortable, whether or not it's peaceful, and whether or not it's legal. And with legislation that's going to come to protect the environment, well, good. We embrace that. But we need to protect it either way. Thank you.
Hi everyone, my name is TJ. I want to bring up, the first thing I want to talk about is they're contesting our point that lasting change is when government is behind it. And I think the example of slavery is a great example that they bring up, because the only way in which things like the Emancipation Proclamation or the 14th, 15th, or 16th Amendment, the 13th, 14th, or 15th Amendment happened is because a room full of white men decided that it was in their best interest as a nation to create this legislation. And so the idea is that direct action isn't ever actually enough. Slave revolts aren't ever actually enough. Things like the Jim Brown riot, the Jim Brown rebellion in Virginia is never actually enough to create change. You have to convince the oppressors that it is in their best interest to alleviate oppression, because they are the people that have, who control the means of power. Now, direct action is not a good way to do this, because Joe makes a great argument in his first speech that all direct action does is alienate people. It alienates people's livelihoods. When you try to destroy lotteries, when you try to destroy coal mines, it alienates the coal miners, it alienates the loggers. These are the very people who you need to get on your side if you're ever actually going to change anything. And I think a great example of this is there have been recently been going a bunch of viral videos that have been going around about people asking people who work on Wall Street about Bernie Sanders, and it's proving that a lot of people in that industry actually do support Bernie Sanders, because they realize from within that their own industry is corrupt. And so the idea is that we need to be able to convince these people within power that their own industries, it's not actually in their best interest to destroy the world. Direct action will never be able to do that, because the people who are then able to convince them are labeled terrorists, or are put on FBI watch lists, or are kept out of academic institutions, and kept off of news agencies, and kept off of political platforms in which they're never actually able to engage in these conversations. When people see terrorist groups, and when people see groups using violence labeled as terrorists, they then move away from them, and they then condemn those groups and condemn their arguments. I think Malcolm X is a great example here. The way that Malcolm X is condemned as a terrorist and condemned as a violent actor, when people know, people never get past that, never actually look at their arguments. And then these people are made hyper-visible and are often killed off, which, again, to Joe's point, if our activists are in jail or dead, then how are we ever supposed to actually create change? Now, they again say how direct action is able to create legislative change, but I don't see how things like burning down a slaughterhouse is what actually creates legislative change, because what actually creates legislative change is going to these legislators, is voting, is organizing people through the idea that we can get legislation passed. And sure, we'll give them that the legislation that's currently passed isn't enough, but the idea is that we're moving towards progress. Direct action is the idea that we have to suddenly get there in one day or in one action, but that's never going to happen. If they agree that legislation is the end point, then all direct action does is alienate legislation, because it moves beyond those systems and assumes that you have direct power over these systems, when instead you have to influence these systems. I think we're going to ultimately win this debate because they have no answer to the idea of how do we actually change situations, like things like the Black Browns that I brought up, like things like SeaWorld. Burning them down and breaking down these institutions in one moment is not enough, because they'll be rebuilt the next day. Those slaughterhouses will be rebuilt. The hunters will buy new vehicles. They'll buy new guns. They'll continue to fight this. The only way that we actually change things is by changing people's minds. And direct action is not the best way to change people's minds. It's the best way to alienate them and further force them to be against you and further force them to resist you. I think we're going to win this debate because we are going to win that legislation. That legislation is the key starting point, and the only way to get to legislation is by actually speaking to people and trying to convince the people who are oppressing the environment, rather than trying to blow up their factories or burning down their houses, because that only further makes them hate environmentalists. That makes them call environmentalists terrorists, and that's not something that this movement needs. Yeah, I'm good.
Cross-examination coming up. So if anybody has any questions that you have. Take like 30 seconds. Yeah. Not curling.
Whenever you're ready to begin the cross-examination period, it's instance could have in the press that brings people together, that creates a movement, wouldn't that have an effect larger than just simply talking to people or policy?
No, because the media controls the spin of those events. So like when you see a factory is blown up on television or they're reporting about someone burning down like a logging mill, those people will quickly be labeled as terrorists. They will quickly be labeled as criminals. And so like you don't get to control the spin or the narrative of your actions, which means that you're quickly going to be moved out of the political system because you're going to be seen as extreme.
So do you agree with everything that you hear on the news?
I mean, it's not a question of agreeing, but it's a question of how you get access to political platforms if you're labeled a terrorist, if you're on government watch lists, if you are agreed to be a taboo person by the mainstream media. You don't get access to the forums that you need to convince the average person.
You know, America loves taboo people. You know, the whole outlaw mystique in America is just like overwhelming, and like basically every movie exists, you know, talking about these people. This is exciting, you know, the reality TV show is based on that. So, you know, everyone who watches that news story and hears the stiff guy, the stiff white guy with the tie saying that these people are horrible, these people are terrorists, there's somebody else out there sitting there, you know, on their couch, playing their video games, looking up, thinking, you know what, I think those people are kind of interesting. I was never interested in environmental issues before because they were always so boring. But now, this looks interesting. I mean, you think that what the government tells people to think is exactly what people think?
I feel like that's a problematic reason to get people interested into terrorism, because into environmental action, because then it becomes about the excitement of terrorism rather than actually about saving the environment. But also, it's the question of, do you ever get invited to CNN to speak on these places? Do you ever get to directly speak to people? Direct action never gets to control its own narrative.
No, but yes, I have been invited to CNN dozens of times, and 60 Minutes and NBC Nightly News and Good Morning America.
Maybe you do, but that just gets back to Joe's point about how direct action is privileged, because again,
they
white
didn't even
have
to say.
If you'd like to take a minute to prepare your closing speech, you can, or you can be like, you have 3 minutes. In the 30s or a terrorist in the 2000s, that, you know, nobody's going to understand you, nobody's going to listen to what you have to say. And of course, that's true to an extent, but at the same time, you know, there are all kinds of people in this world that are interested and excited about and drawn into things through all different ways. If you see a movement that exists and the only ways that this movement enacts is through lobbying and holding signs and signing petitions, etc., you know, there's certain people who are turned on by that, except that activity. They're interested in joining up with that movement. There's a whole different segment of society that perhaps watches a lot of football, that perhaps, you know, likes racing cars, or perhaps is never interested in the media at all, that might be all of a sudden interested in things like, say, the Boston Tea Party, which, by the way, was direct action. So, you know, you have a whole historical precedent of movements that have existed and have gained success through the use of direct action, whether they're
civil rights movements, suffrage movements, the revolution of this country right here in America when it was fighting for its liberty from Britain. You know, the same thing with the ones that we sort of tokenize as being only nonviolent, like the civil rights movement or the independence movement in India, which was filled with violent direct action. Gandhi was not the only actor in that movement. And so, you know, the idea here is that the corporate media, the media is controlled by the government and the corporations. The corporations pay for advertising, and it decides what is said and what is not said on the media. They weren't even talking about, quote, global warming, which is what it was called back in the 90s on the news, at all. You know, it was, scientists were all coming out and saying, oh, you know, the global environment's getting warm, the ozone layer is depleting, et cetera, et cetera. But politicians all said that it was a hoax, that it was environmental fraud. You know, and they've waited and bought another 15, 20 years of pollution and destruction. You know, but the reason that changed in large part is because people fought hard. They fought hard through the Sea Shepherds and they went to jail. Many of our people throughout history have gone to jail. We're very respectful of these people that martyred and gone to jail, like Martin Luther King, like Rosa Parks, like Harriet Tubman, you know, people who were wanted by the government. And now we look back and say, you know what, they were doing the right thing. That was a good thing. Like, you know, it was important that they risk these things. Direct action is something that breaks through the media talking about, you know, the Brad Pitt's wedding or whatever incessantly. You know, all of a sudden, when a building burns down and it costs $1 billion in damage, they have to do a story on it. They cannot ignore global warming anymore. When people go out and cause a big scene because of global warming, now they're talking about it. And that's what happened in the late 90s. SUVs were being burnt all across the country, and it was getting tons of press. And the next thing you know, the Vice President of the United States makes a documentary called An Inconvenient Truth. And it's not global warming anymore. It's now called climate change, and all the politicians are recognizing it. Direct action has an effect in the world in a very real way, and no real change has ever happened without people fighting for it and risking and sacrificing. And that's what direct action is.
So, one inconvenient truth that is forgotten is that people are interested in themselves. A vice president can make a documentary about inconvenient truths, but it doesn't get people to change their lives from looking for convenience. SUVs got burned across the country, and people still drive SUVs. The fact that direct action causes backlash means that far more people are going to rally against the proposals that people who are promoting on the streets are trying to push than are going to come forth. The Black Lives Matter movement shows that there was a groundswell of support until the CVS burned down, and then all the news talked about was the CVS burning down. All the people on Facebook and Twitter and all the social media was talking about is, look at these thugs who are just burning property and hurting individuals. And what got forgotten was the police brutality and the necessity for that movement to have been sparked in the first place. If instead of attacking personal property and trying to burn down buildings or spike trees or sink boats or burn SUVs, that energy is directed towards actually telling people why it's in their best interest to not drive an SUV. Why is it in their best interest to not clear cut a forest? Why is it in the best interest to not overfish our oceans? That's far more likely to promote change because people are self-interested. When you alienate people and they lose their jobs or their livelihoods or their house gets burned down, they're not going to join you. They're going to work against you. When you have your leaders being put in jail or being killed on the streets, that's not going to create a long-term movement because you need them out there actually promoting forms of action in order to be able to promote those initiatives, which means that you need to be able to stay out of jail and you need to be able to engage in legal forms of action in order to create necessary reforms. Now, one of the things that my opponent continues to say is that direct action inspires people. It cuts through the media haze in order to be able to, so that way we're not just talking about who's getting married in the celebrity world, but we'll talk about important environmental issues. While that might put the environmental issues on the map, it doesn't get the legislation to change. What does get the legislation to change is when people get into the halls of government and engage in meaningful dialogue and interaction in terms of civil discourse in order to be able to say, how can we take a step to make it better? And it might be slow going, but the attempt and the hope that we can just wish the world to be a better place is a naive one that will never actually be able to cement any form of long-lasting change. Rather, we need to be able to take not just the signs on the streets in order to be able to inform people, but come up with real ways where you can reach out to people and make those forms of connections. If you alienate people, that simply just does not happen. One of the things that they had said in cross-examination is that we need to force people to listen. But when that forcing people to listen risks personal injury to individuals who might be in the factory when it gets burnt down, or might hurt the logger when they cut down the tree, that forcing society good as them, opposed to when they think you're working to try and destroy their livelihoods, which is why the best way to promote environmental change is to work within the system to create a legislative initiative that can then actually create the lasting change that is necessary. And we might have to do more work, but that's the only way things are going to get done. Thank you.
The opposition side, this question asks, how would legislation work on a global scale, given that the environmental issues are global as opposed to just the U.S.? You should consider that other countries do not necessarily have the political power that we have as a democracy or a capitalist society. So,
There are some forms of international law that have had, you know, varying different degrees of success. But part of the thing that will be able to convince other countries to come on board is showing them why it's in their best interest. China pollutes a lot because they think it's in their best interest to mine rare earth minerals and not care about the environment. If we engage with them in discourse about how it would be in their own country's best interest, health-wise, economically, that would be more likely to create international and other countries to be able to create that necessary change. If the Chinese government just thinks that the environmental activists are out there to burn down their factories, they're going to have even more harsh laws that's going to prevent civil discourse from being able to emerge in that country as well.
Okay.
Yeah, of course.
I think one of the issues is, like, what if it's not in their best interest? Like, what if it's not in a country's or a politician's best interest to protect the environment? And the environment needs to be protected, like, obviously, because of climate change that's going on, because of the destruction and deforestation. So how would you go about protecting the environment if it's not in someone's best interest?
I think your whole point is, though, it is in their best interest.
What if it's not a specific best interest?
But if we don't do something about our global climate right now, everyone is going to die. And I think that is a message that you can convince rich billionaires with, because if they die, all their corporations, all their money dies. I think that's something that China is finally starting to learn, and China is finally starting to move towards not polluting their rivers and reducing smog in their city.
I think this
they're realizing they're gonna die.
A good time for the next question. So how would you answer to the question of how this debate fares in other topics? So given her example, how would we be able to convince a Middle Eastern country whose main profits are from oil extraction and petroleum, how would we convince that leader or that country citizenship to make legislation against these harmful practices?
Supply demand issue, right? So, like, if we change our demand for oil, then there's not as much economic incentive for them to be able to mine oil. So if we change our consumption habits, that could change those other various forms of actions. You could also internationally negotiate by giving, you know, subsidies to other industries, or you could be able to, you know, tit for tat, where the United States could offer some economic benefit or leverage or something else that's desirable for different Middle Eastern countries for slowing down oil production. But so long as people are willing to consume it, they're going to continue to, you know, drill for it.
Just like to respond, you know, to point out that the system, whether it's our system here in the United States or any other government, you know, they're not ignorant of these issues. It's not simply that they don't know that, you know, these forests are being cut down and that the air and the oceans are being polluted. They're fully aware of it. In fact, it's most of the time it's their scientists and their grant money that's for funding the research that's proving these things. So it's not a matter of ignorance that they just need to be enlightened to it. It's a matter of that they simply don't care. Their priorities are capitalistic. Their priorities are making money. They're willing to destroy that ocean to make more money. It's not in the government's interest. The government isn't going to die when the planet dies, because the government is not alive. The people die, right? The animals die, the environment dies. The government is not a different thing. So it's really, what is really in the government's best interest, whether it's the United States government or China or anywhere else, is profit, right? It's economic growth. So You have to make that distinction when understanding this. If you're just trying to petition a government to make change, it'll do that to some extent. You know, it'll make some changes here and there to keep you happy, to keep you from uprising and shutting them down. But really, their interest is always going to be the same thing. It's always profit and exploitation, because that's the nature of the beast.
So I had a very interesting point that I picked up during the debate. And you mentioned that activism sometimes borderlines with terrorism and just frowned upon actions. So how do we distinguish activism, whether it be political or environmental, from terrorism, especially when we consider his argument about the Founding Fathers, whether they be considered terrorists?
Well, one, I don't think my point was that it's not a question of demonizing terrorism. I think terrorism, in a lot of ways, can be legitimate action, which is their point. What I'm saying is the way terrorism has now become a buzzword within culture, where anyone who does any kind of violent action is quickly labeled a terrorist, and obviously this label often has racialized and regionalized connotations, but like that ability for people to constantly be labeled terrorists, to be labeled violent criminals, is what moves them out of the political sphere and what delegitimizes their arguments.
Like just today, someone was sentenced to 2 years in jail for violating the Animal Enterprise Terrorism Act for freeing animals that are going to be turned into fur. And that has not helped to stop the fur industry. All it has done is created a bright young activist being put in jail. What would have stopped the fur industry was convincing people that fur is not in their best interest to buy, and that fur is a luxury item that takes up their money and that doesn't actually keep you that much warmer and that will degrade over time, and causing people to change through other actions, opposed to now having the entire animal rights community branded as terrorists.
Yeah, you're saying that, like, you know, committing acts like that discredits someone and that it, you know, discredits the community. But what if there's that one act that creates a snowball effect where it does, you know, motivate more people to understand the issue, it motivates more people to read up on it, motivates more people to look into it and understand their side of it as well?
Well, I mean, I think Joe really gets that in the last speech when he's talking about, like, sure, maybe, you know, burning down cities in the 90s led to, like, the vice president creating an inconvenient truth, but the bottom line is still in 2016, we have people in Congress looking outside and saying, oh, look, it's cold out. Global warming is not a thing. So, you know, it hasn't actually created the institutional change that is actually needed. Right now, institutionally, we still look like we did in the 1990s because the same climate change disbelievers are still in Congress.
And in the meantime, all these years, there have been constant, consistent, and relentless legislative changes. So if you're arguing that direct action, you know, hasn't brought about the right kind of legislation changes to solve these problems, well, neither has everything that's been happening that's been legal all these years, too. You know, and, you know, a big part of that is because these movements, if you're really going to make change that has significant, lasting results, you know, it requires the implementation of this. Ultimately, and if you're not recognizing that and thinking that these problems can be solved just through legislation, well, we've had legislation consistently for well over two centuries now here in the United States, and guess what? We have problems on top of problems on top of problems. Problems that they say they solved through the 13th Amendment. Hey, guess what? Black Lives Matter is still here. It's not solved. And it's that way with every other movement.
So, I mean, you say you gotta throw it, that we have to get rid of the system. Like, do you then envision a world where there's not a government and that everyone's just taking action? Like, when you say get rid of the system, what do you mean?
That is such a common reaction. I mean, I don't have an answer to all the best way to rule the world, but you know what? I can still have validity in saying that what's going on now with global, you know, ecological annihilation is inexcusable and we cannot afford to do it any longer. Let's try something else. You know, I don't know what is exactly perfect, and I don't actually believe that there is a perfect way, personally. But not doing this another century would be a real good start.
Thank you everyone for coming, and I specifically want to thank Mr. Leeson and James Pickering for coming out for us.